What I'd like to do next is show you just a few ways that you can get started with Jupyter notebooks. You see, this notebook that I have open here right now is actually a local Jupyter notebook. As you can see up here in the URL, it says localhost port 8888. Now, this is one possibility, is simply hosting Jupyter notebooks locally on your own computer. And basically, all that that means is that you're running a server behind the scenes, and you can access that server as well as run Python code by interacting with this interface here. However, there are lots of other ways that you can do this as well. One way that a lot of people really like is by using a cloud-based Jupyter hosting solution, and for that, a very common one is a site called Anaconda Cloud. So if you just look up Anaconda Cloud and then find the button on the page that says something like open a new notebook, you will get to something that looks a lot like what you see here. And notice that these two things are pretty similar. The interfaces are a little bit different, but the same concept applies, right? This thing that you see in the middle of the page is a Jupyter notebook, and you can just do the same kind of thing in here as we did in the previous one. All right, so if you want to say for I in X, print X times 2, right? And then we can run this here. You'll see that, same mistake as we made last time. We can change that now back to I times 2, and you'll see that that will fix it and print out the result. All right, so using the Anaconda Cloud does have a number of benefits, right? It's for one, it allows you to kind of manage all of your stuff in one place so that, if you're logging on from multiple computers, you can always access this. But it also has a lot of additional plugins and stuff like, this AI assistant, Anaconda Assistant, now that you can start using to help it write code for you, although I would recommend actually holding off on that until you've learned the ins and outs of working with Jupyter, just so you don't get too reliant on it. But anyway, that's just another option for you. If you prefer to use all of your stuff kind of on the cloud, then the Anaconda Cloud is a great option there. But if you want to do everything locally, what you can actually do is download something called the Anaconda distribution. And that's actually what I have running over here in my other tab, the one on localhost 8888, there we go. I'm not sure how many I said the first time, but anyway, that's what I have running here. And the Anaconda distribution is basically it's one of several different so-called distributions, basically just meaning that it's something you can install locally and run, and it already has a lot of the major packages installed for you. So as we'll see a little bit later on when we start using things like pandas or NumPy or visualization libraries, all of those come pre-installed with this Anaconda distribution, which isn't necessarily true if you use some other distribution or a different strategy for running Jupyter notebooks locally. So anyway, if you want to use this distribution locally, you can always just go to anaconda.com/download, and it does want you to put in your email address, which I think is a little bit annoying. So I actually discovered that you can just put in /success there up at the top, and that'll take you right to the download page. But that they may change that. They may watch that video and get annoyed with me that I showed you that and change it. So you might just have to put in your email address. But anyway, that'll take you to the distribution specific for your operating system. And from there, it's just a basic installer. And once it's finished, you should be able to open up something called the Anaconda Navigator, which is just going to be an application on your computer at that point. And as you can see, it's got a lot of different options in here. The easiest one to get started with is just this Jupyter notebook thing there. If you click launch, what that'll do is it'll open up a little, a little terminal that looks like this. It'll run for a few seconds, and then it will open up a tab here like what you see here. All right, So that's just another option there. I think that this is the option I'm going to be using myself just because it's easier for recording these courses to do this all locally. But you could also do that in the Anaconda cloud there if you wanted to. And there's some things that I might do on here versus locally. And another thing to notice here too is if you... the first thing that opens up is going to look a lot like this when you do that local... Anaconda distribution, and this basically just allows you to select files from your local computer that you want to open. So what you'll notice is that this current file that I'm in is called untitled.ipynb. That's it stands for IPython Notebook. And IPython is just, that in turn stands for Interactive Python. Lots and lots of, abbreviations within abbreviations here, but that's just a special file format for basically what you see here, right? It's Python, but it's separated into cells. So anyway, those are two options for getting up and running with this. If you really want to do everything yourself and you don't want to install any distributions or anything like that, what you can actually do, and this is actually the notebook that I have open in the in my browser here, so I'll create another one. I'll say something like local notebook. Oops, there we go. Local notebook dot ipynb. Right. If you name any file with dot ipynb inside IDEs such as Visual Studio Code, although I'm sure a lot of other ones allow you to do that as well, you'll see that that'll give you a very similar interface, although in this case it's going to be a little bit more, the theme is going to look a lot more like Visual Studio Code. So you can do the same thing in here as what you could do there. Really the main difference between just using regular old notebooks in Visual Studio Code and actually using them on a distribution or on the cloud is that you have to do a lot of the setup yourself. So as you'll see here... we'll say for I in X, and then we'll say print I times 2. All right, well, if we run this just by clicking this run all button, what you'll see is that it wants us to select a kernel. Now, the kernel, we'll talk about this in more detail shortly, but the Python kernel is basically what takes care of running our code and also keeps track of all of the current variables that we have in scope, etc. So we just have to select whichever one we want there. I'm just going to select Python 3.11.5. It doesn't really matter too much which one you choose unless you're using the latest features. And sure enough, it'll run it, and we'll see that it prints out everything there. So anyway, that's just one more way that you can get started with Python notebooks. Which one of these you use is going to depend on your preferences, but again, I'm going to probably be using this localhost version for a lot of the course, right? A lot of the demonstrations that we do in this course. So again, it's up to you, but I'm going to be using this one. So I'd recommend that you get that set up by using the anaconda.com/download/success link. So anyway, I hope this has been informative for you, and I'd like to thank you for viewing.